It's 6:32. We're going to call the order. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please. Dr. Spencer? Mrs. Servio?
Here.
Mr. Sellers?
Here.
Mrs. Ross is here. Mr. Lipsky?
Here.
Mrs. Hilton?
Here.
Mrs. Dubé?
Here.
6-1.
Thank you. Hearing of school district patrons, we could read the
thank you.
Fun stuff.
Even though I have it out, I don't always do it, right?
There you go.
Okay. Addressing the board. The Board of Education of Lance Creuse Public Schools has adopted the following guidelines for public participation at school board meetings. The agenda for all public meetings includes a designated time called hearing of school district patrons for public comment. If you wish to address the board during a Board of Education meeting, please note the following guidelines. Individuals may speak to the board during the hearing of district patrons. Each speaker needs to identify him or herself by name and address. Speakers need to limit their comments to 5 minutes and will be notified by a timer when their time is up. The board is designated 30 minutes for public, comment at the beginning of the meeting. If you are unable to speak in the first public comment portion of the meeting, the board will provide additional time at the end of the meeting for public comment. The order of speakers will be determined by the secretary. If the speaker represents an organization or group, he or she should indicate whether the comments represent the official view of the organization or are his or her personal comments. If a delegation is present to address the board, the delegation may be asked to select up to 5 representatives to speak on its behalf for a total of not more than 15 minutes. Written comments should be given to the board secretary and are considered public documents. If you wish to state a complaint against a board member, an employee, or a student, an initial allegation is permitted. Thereafter, the affected individual may request further discussion takes place in a closed session pursuant to the Open Meetings Act. In general, issues brought to the board's attention will be referred to the superintendent for investigation and study, and a response will be provided at a later date. These guidelines are based on the requirements for open meetings under Section 5 of the Open Meetings Act. So, 2. Jody Lozinski. Yeah, where are they going to go?
Is there an area you want
there, yours usually is. Hold on. Normally.
I can give them a hand on my or a diary to this side.
Yep, over here.
Chesterfield, I have 2 school-aged children. I have been to the last couple of school board meetings to bring awareness of critical race theory, or CRT, a divisive ideology and dogma that is being implemented in some school districts across the country. I share this concern with many other parents in our district. Superintendent Eloff has assured me that this divisive ideology is not present in our district, and we thank him for that. What I would like to address further, however, is our role as parents in the district. We need to ask our kids how certain things are being taught. Don't take "I don't know" for an answer. If your kids are like mine, we know that is often the general response to most questions we ask our kids regarding school. Push them for a real answer. If they are in a government or civics class, ask them how their governmental system is being talked about and taught. Is it taught in a positive or negative light? In their history classes, ask your kids how America is being framed in their lessons and in the text that they're studying from. Is America framed as an inherently racist country, made up only of the oppressed and the oppressors? Is race needlessly brought into subjects where it has no business being in there, such as math or gym or something like that? Are kids asked purposely to look at, value, and assign certain categories and characteristics to individuals based on their skin color instead of their individual character? Because that is what the divisive ideology of CRT teaches. believe most parents want from our public education is to be free from the divisive and improper ideology, whether it's called CRT or some other euphemism that teaches the same thing that seems to be gaining traction around the country. I believe that we want our students taught actual facts, not a divisive ideology. Thank you.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
Is Atlas Rubicon, is our social studies curriculum on that?
It is.
Okay, perfect.
Whenever you're ready.
My name is Pam Sape. I live at 53236 Pine Ridge Drive in Chesterfield. And my comments today are, I'm sure everybody's heard about the two gals in Virginia that were sexually molested in a restroom from a transgender male. So my comment is, I would like to know what Lance Creuse, what the criteria is for their girls' bathrooms in transgender. Male going female, how that is set up. And then I would also like to know if, which I'm thinking no because I've done a few FOIAs, but I want to make sure that we have not purchased the Panorama education system.
Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you.
All right, on to our presentations. First, zero-based budget.
Thank you. So I'd like to reintroduce Matt Sobey to the board. He is working with us this school year on our zero-based budgeting process. He came to you with introduction. Weeks ago, presented to the board. Today was a work session that he worked with our administrators, our building administrators, us that were here, as well as department heads. It was a large group of people, and he was just reflecting on their input to the process and discussing their involvement. So he's here back tonight to report that to the board about the event, what they told him, and then ask for your feedback as well. So, Don, thank you.
Thank you very much. For those of you that were on the Zoom, I'm the owner of a CPA firm, and that's the group that is presenting this tonight. I've had over 40 years of experience in the school business, and we had a great meeting today. You're being very proactive. We're talking about 22-23 budget, and this is the perfect time to start that discussion for planning ahead. And part of this is looking at the strategic plan that you have and how we tie in the finance to that strategic plan. I was talking earlier, oftentimes we have the strategic plan developed over here and it's maybe not as much finance related, and over here we have the budget taking place. But this process is designed to marry those two functions. So that the finance, you actually end up with a financial strategic plan when you're done and we move ahead with budget for 22-23 based upon that strategic plan. So let me give you a little insight. Why do zero-based budgeting? Well, number one, it's going to help fund that strategic plan. There are a lot of strategic plans that are developed in school districts that just don't get the funding behind them. So we actually had some of that discussion today. It opens up a conversation. When do you actually get an opportunity to talk about budget going forward in relation to the big picture? In many school districts, it's pretty rushed by the time we get to May and June. So this is, you know, good reflection right now before your district moves forward. We wanted the influence of the principals. We wanted the influence. We want to hear from the board as we go through this. We're going to go section by section and see if you have some feedback. We're going to move quickly, but I think it's going to be helpful for you. And as we look at this, every line in the budget needs to have a job. When we talked before, when you do a rollover budget year after year after year, you lose focus on what might be in that budget. I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about school districts in general. So we want every line in there, we need to know what every line the purpose is, otherwise we ought to not have that line. We want to minimize the variance, so your auditor is here tonight, and I'm sure your auditor would be all about how do we minimize variances in our budget versus the actual. And there's been some good research on this at GFOA. I talked about that last time, GFOA, Government Finance Officers Association. We want to narrow that, because when we narrow that and we know it up front, we can then allocate some of those dollars to needed programs that maybe have been put on the back burner. We're going to have a sustainability focus. By sustainability, I mean your financial sustainability. I look back on some of your history some years ago, and it was getting a little tight for my consideration. I want you to have strength. I want you to look ahead, and I want you to plan ahead and do that forecasting. It also helps develop leaders. Oftentimes in school districts, if we look at our principals, talk to our principals, they've only been involved in a small fraction of the budget. We want them to understand it all before they leave, and that's what this process is gonna do, because they're gonna be asked to help make some of the tough decisions when that first draft comes in and it's out of balance. We're going to wait for their input before we do anything else. It's going to open up some transparency, some things that, you know, not everybody knew. And the budget process is quite difficult. It's very complex. But we're going to talk about all the points in there as this process unfolds. This, at the end of the day in May and June, is actually the superintendent's budget. He makes a recommendation to the board, but the group is going to be working to influence that superintendent's budget along with Rochelle and the cabinet. All this is based on a lot of good research, decades of zero-based budgeting practice, and GFOA research we're bringing into this process, which is cutting edge. So we start by looking at the budget development goals. We want to tie them into the mission, your strategic plan. And we looked at this first thing today to refresh our memory. And this is what your mission is: the learning community, global society. And we're looking at some of the key words right now. What is your vision? Now, moving quickly, I'm not going to read this. I'm just picking out some of the highlights: critical thinkers, diversity, individual contributions, building relationships, teacher support, high-level thinking, engaging students, technology, vision. What do we want going forward? Community members, business and alumni partner, those partnerships. Parents collaborate with staff. Lifelong learning. And you have a belief statement that I really like. It makes all the sense in the world: high academic and behavioral expectations, learning environment, global society, each student's individual strengths and abilities, fiscal responsibility. Of course, accountants always like fiscal responsibility. And I can say that I'm very happy with the product that your business office puts out. I did get a peek at your audit and your single audit, and it's very, very good. I don't find that in a lot of districts, but I find that your structure and your personnel here for fiscal is excellent. Respect for all individuals, collaboration, tradition and history. So with that was the backdrop this morning. We started with that. And then we zero-based process. On the right, if you look at this, I think the board members have seen this before. This is the basis for moving forward. So no longer would we just roll over what was there last year, but we'd have discussion. We'd understand what would be in there. We'd be looking at proposals from the various cost centers. So here are the cost centers, and we've talked about that. These are still evolving a little bit, but I think it's settling down. So each of these areas would be providing reports to the cabinet. That information will then be reported to the board. Cost centers, here are some more. So what would some of the budget development goals be? I gave them a couple of them, and the members today contributed the rest. This was my language, budgetary cost centers, monthly review, you know, getting people to understand those budgets. Transparent, consultative, resulting in a recommendation by the superintendent to the board. We need to understand those curricular needs in relation to budget. This came from the group this morning, and we need to hear more about that. What are those needs? That was the first thing I think was said from the group. Consider equity between buildings. In other words, let's look at all the elementary. Does it make sense the dollars allocated to elementary A versus elementary B? And acknowledge the specific needs that they have in each building. There are some accounts we use per pupil allocations, and we'll be talking more about that. And the per student funding applies for some accounts, not all accounts. Maximize budget development to eliminate and enhance efficiencies. So this is today, so I'm going to have some grammatical corrections, okay, by the time you see it next. I've got the extra word in there. But to enhance efficiencies. Budget flexibility. Somebody brought up, well, are we really going to be that rigid? No, we're not going to be that rigid. We're going to figure out how we can develop some flexibility for unintended consequences. We need everybody to understand the large district-wide needs. You're going to hear some of those needs a little bit later in terms of facilities, but we need everybody to understand them. It's not only one person's ownership or two. Be able to make some specific decisions on some individual needs. And this is really the language from your folks, and that is part of the process. We want them to be making decisions or recommendations on some of their needs. Distinguish between various building initiatives versus district mandates. What is self-supporting and what is district-wide funding? There are some accounts that are self-supporting. You know, food service ought to be self-supporting, and then other accounts ought to be district-wide funded. So we need to understand those by the time we're done with the process. Somebody said, be smart. Great. Let's be smart about budgeting those funds. GFOA process is smarter school spending. So whoever contributed that was right on with the research. Understand the funding sources for specific building needs. Opportunity to propose new initiatives. This process is all about the ability to propose new initiatives. We may not be able to afford everything, but maybe we need to look at some trade-offs as this process unfolds. They will certainly have the opportunity to provide new initiatives. Transparency for the cost centers is going to be like our principals and supervisors have never seen before. And right now, Rochelle has been working on that structure. We have a structure completed for one of the elementaries, and she'll be working on that and all of the cost structures. And we have had some discussion that there are some things that maybe need to be realigned a little bit on how things are budgeted and charged out. So already we're thinking of some things that are going to help you in the long run. here's where we're going to need some additional input. So I'm going to see, do you have any other development, budget development goals that we haven't covered as a board member that you think ought to be contributed to this? Is there anything as we've gone through that, that did we miss something? You know, I think there was good thought this morning, and this is a work in progress for a month or so here. But is there any feedback that you would like to add to this?
Anyone?
And if not, that's fine.
Can I ask a question?
Come back to it.
Sure.
Don, can I ask a question?
Yes.
And I guess maybe it's okay to say you can't answer or whatever, but just what I've always thought. I thought that we did a pretty good job as a district of being equitable in things of buildings, whether it's structural things that need to be done or programs in a building or something like that. So that one comment about being more equal kind of struck me. It sort of felt like, oh, I guess I didn't really, and we get these, you know, look back, so what do we need to do? What are the big things, what are the little things, 5-year, 10-year, whatever. So that just struck me as like, have we failed them in that way, or is this just a thought that someone said was a good thing to keep on the front of our...
I think it's something to keep in front of us.
Okay.
And, you know, the fact that everybody didn't see everybody else's budget, which they will in this process,
okay,
they'll understand everybody's budget. There may be something small, I don't know. The per pupil allocations that we're still going to keep are going to make sense in largely the elementaries,
okay,
middle school, and high school. No, I don't see that as any deficiency right now.
Okay.
So go ahead. Mary?
I'll wait.
And then Terry? Terry? Oh.
Mm-hmm.
She said she'll wait.
Oh.
I just wonder, we're in the process so that once each of the cost centers work and develop their goals and they build their budget based on that. That is a good thing because then that thinking, you're getting the best of everybody's thinking at the local district or local school level. And then that comes forward. Is there a part of the process that's a sharing process so that if this elementary school had these ideas and notions and another elementary would have heard about that, perhaps then that might change something? That's question one. And then the follow-up to that is, once that has been done at the cost center level, then the more difficult thing is that the school district could have priorities, also to tie with our strategic plan and our goals. So how does that get reconciled? There are some cases with some of the state and federal programs that require the school building to have a plan and to not have any sort of heavy hand from the central office in that regard. So I understand that, but overall and in general, how can you make sure that the goals of the district, because someone, our superintendent, our central office team, has got to really look at that and make sure that we take care of district priorities as well as the top priorities of the school. Can you speak to that?
Sure. Let's first talk about the buildings. Let's talk about elementaries for a minute and make sure one elementary is somewhat comparable to another. We're asking them to work together. So we're asking all the elementaries to work together. They're going to have a training in December, all of them. And our next step is, okay, elementaries, we need you to meet and kind of work on this together. Same with the middle schools and the high schools. So there hopefully is a common theme. We're going to give them all the forms and all the process going forward. So when you see our timeline, which is on at the end here, you're going to see quite a series of meetings they're going to hear everyone else's requests in those meetings, which they have never done that. So this is a structure that allows that. That's when we compare notes. But all those cost centers, facilities, and grants and everything else, they're going to have presentations to cabinet as well. Nobody's exempt from having a presentation. Mm-hmm. So we're going to hear the entire school district listening or issue of needs. So that's when we bring it together, and that'll make more sense when I show you the timeline in a little bit.
So the second part of that is then, so once that's occurred and it gets called out with the central office team and our superintendent, is there a specific process that you suggest or that we will use in trying to make sure that the highest priorities of the schools are, but as well as the district?
It's a group thing. So we have all the needs. Let's say we get all these needs in, and the first budget that comes together is put together by the business office. We haven't taken anything out at that point. So we sit down and look at it and say, wow, this is out of balance. We cannot recommend this going forward for the superintendent. So it's the group thing, week after week after week, that helps bring this together in what's logical. We're asking the principals to participate in budget and supervisors more than they ever have, which means they need to understand their lines and see their lines. So it's that process week by week until it comes into balance that makes it work.
So I guess the last thing I'd say is the unavoidable situation that will occur would be something like Rochelle, as our chief business official, is obligated to, what she's charged with is to make sure that every decision as much as possible will help bring us into financial stability, okay? Curriculum person, not so much the money, so she's going to advocate for the things that will enhance and improve the curriculum for the teaching and learning. And when all, those are all important things, but those leaders are obligated to really advocate for improvements in their areas. But in the end, the very, very difficult thing is, you know, how will it call out in the end where somebody's going to have to make a decision on?
Well, certainly it is the superintendent's budget.
Okay.
And we're all trying to influence him. It's really his budget. And
it's
that's
our
why
budget.
All the information out on the table.
Right.
Initially, it's not a bid here, a bid here. This is more scientific of an approach to budget than most districts use. So I haven't found a district when we get done with this that says, oh, that didn't work. They're raving about it, and they're ready to do it the next year. And even the principals are saying, oh, we could never go back to the way that we were before.
Right. Thank you.
Amy?
Help me understand the process. Elementary schools all get together and they give an allocated a sum of money.
For some account.
And then they decide, there's a basic premise that they all get the same amount on to run a basic school.
Yeah.
But then there's adding and subtracting for the needs. One school may need
more. Let me clarify that a little bit. We have two different approaches. One is all the FTEs in the building. We want them to identify their FTEs now.
Mm-hmm.
And what is the proposal for next year for FTE teachers? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Then we have this other small pot of money. It's really quite small in relation to the total that is teaching supplies and that type of thing. So that's on a per student allocation, this small bit of money. When we talk about the FTE teachers, that's when we'll hear advocating for this or that. But when they're working together as a group, it's likely to come out quite similar.
And then there's an allocation for the FTEs. There's an allocation
No allocation for the FTE We're just going to listen to what they say and understand what they have versus what's going forward. Okay. That's not on an allocation basis.
But then that you have a sum of money that is allocated for supplies and and that's supply. But the, what about if Mr. Smith and his principal school wants to put a new playground in?
Yeah.
Is that allocated? But
not allocated. They're going to have to justify it.
Justify it. All right.
Yeah.
And then, but another school wants to put a playground in. Do they equally get the same amount of money, or is it justification?
That goes over into a whole other consideration. That's capital outlay, which is likely going to have to be handled differently from just regular general
fund. So capital outlay is different than...
It's very likely, but, and you're going to see some of that as we go forward. Let me ask you, because you're going to still hear some of the explanation, everything that you're asking. Big picture budget development goals, is there anything we're missing that ought to be added? Because I'm going to get into more of the weeds here in a minute. Now, this isn't the end of this process, so if we don't get them today, we can pick them up another time. Permit me to go forward.
I have a question still.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. First of all, it's the board's budget. It's not the superintendent's budget. So, but let's just call it a spade a spade. What role does the finance department in this building have in what you're doing?
Let me clarify. The Unified Budgeting and Accounting Act does hold the superintendent responsible.
I'm not interested in a clarification.
And the finance office is supporting of the superintendent in the preparation.
My question was, what role does the finance office in this building have on this process?
They're deeply involved with it. And this is really a training. This whole thing is a training session for the entire organization. My firm is not developing the budget, but it's training your personnel, your principals and supervisors, and the finance office too. So this will be replicated year after year.
So training. But what role do they have in developing this budget?
What role does who have?
What role does the finance office in this building have in developing this budget?
Sure. Let me just say, you have one of the finest finance offices I have seen.
Then why do we need you?
The numbers are right there.
Then why do we need you?
Pardon me?
I said, then why do we need you?
Well,
if we have one of the finest finance departments, you're kind of talking me out of your job. Why do we need you if they're fabulous?
This is a system that we're proposing and that the board has adopted, so they want to go forward with this. And this
I understand
is
that. What I'm saying is that
research,
if they're fabulous, why do we need you?
Can we hear his answer?
What can you do for us that they're not doing?
We're installing a whole system.
Uh-huh.
I have all the information, all the the history on doing this. I've worked with this for decades and decades. My whole career was working with zero-based budgeting.
I looked you
and
up.
I truly believe it is the way to go. And for your district, this will take you to the next level. There aren't a lot of districts in Michigan that use zero-based budgeting, so you're going to be far advanced from some other districts once this is installed.
It'll take us to the next level of what?
Of long-term planning.
We have a long-term plan. We have a strategic initiative in place. You actually went through the points of the strategic plan in place. I think I'm asking a fair question. If our finance department is fabulous, one of the best you've ever seen, then how are you planning to enhance it? What are you going to do for us that they're not doing?
Let me go through the whole presentation. I think you'll see more of that detail when we get through it, because that is really going to give you the whole picture.
Could I have a copy of this?
I know. Can we get copies of this?
Yeah.
What we're going to do is we're going to take your input tonight, And if we have additions, I'm going to include them in here, and then I'm going to send it back out. You're going to get it, the administrators are going to get it.
I'd like to take notes on it right now.
Yeah.
So, okay. Eric, can we hold for a bit while we get copies?
Sure.
Thank you.
Just for the record, I've just been taking screenshots
and
putting notes on my
mm-hmm.
own paper, so.
Yeah.
And again, this is an input session. We're trying to get input, so if you choose to hold, that's fine.
I'd like a copy.
I need 5 minutes. Okay. We can go ahead and break for 5 minutes. Let's break until 7:15. It's 7:08. We'll break till 7:15.
Don, whenever you're ready.
Okay. I'm going to move along to decision-making parameters. And this is what really helps us make recommendations area by area. So we have programming, we have supplies, capital outlay, we have financial integrity. Those are the big sections that we're going to talk about next. So next, going into programming, understanding that curriculum cycle was the first thing that was mentioned today. And I think that's important. As we go through this process, we need to be educated on that curriculum cycle. So, you know, how long does a textbook last? Is it 10 years, 12 years? What does that cycle look like? And what is that review process? Folks, money where the instructional need exists. Look at those discretionary budgets versus earmarked budgets. Start a process to assess facility needs in relation to programming. So hear from the building principals what those needs are relative to the programming. We're going to hear about facility needs, but in relation to the programming is this one. Look at those consumable resources and understand those budgets. And the training, when we have staff training requirements and we have turnover or there's a new curriculum, make sure we budget for that in the process. Understand the need for support staff for curricular offerings. Understand the recurring costs. You may not always think of it, you know, we have a one-to-one initiative, but what is the recurring cost for those Chromebooks? We've got to have a plan in order to keep that going with that understanding. Look at those recurring costs for future licensing once a program is adopted. When we adopt a program, then oh my gosh, year after year, we have to make sure we're accounting for this licensing. Look at sunset options. Public schools are always good at adding programs, but we tend to accumulate a lot of programs to the point that when we try and add another one, we can't fit in. We can't afford it. But maybe that new program is twice as effective as another program out there. So we're suggesting look at sunset options. GFOA has a tool that I can provide that can help your administrators look at that. IDEX and Unimetrix can help provide an analysis of instructional achievement. I don't know which one your district uses, but that's out here. Also, academic return on investment is a big piece of literature of research today, and I'll be happy to provide information on that when we get to it. So with that, I'm going to stop for a minute and see if you have any feedback on programming before we move on to personnel. Is there anything on the board?
Am I the only one again? Okay. You said focus money where the instructional need exists. How do you determine that? And how often does your process recommend recurrence of that process?
Well, that's a great question because those needs are going to be advocated by the principals or supervisors. So we're going to be listening to those. How often? Some people think, well, once you install zero-based budgeting, it's done. It's every single year. So once this is installed, the cabinet will continue to hear this process year after year.
I don't think you understand my question. How do we determine whether or not an instructional need exists. Is that a determination made by staff members? Is that a determination made by a tool? How does that happen?
We'll ask for justification of all the proposals that are being made. If we need additional data, we'll ask for it.
And who determines?
Who determines what?
If instructional need exists.
We'll have conversation through process.
So you're saying it's a concurrence?
Generally, it is, yes.
Okay. My next question, you said examine sunset options for programming no longer effective. Same type of thing. How is that determined? Is there a cost-benefit analysis that's done for programs that are concerned to be effective or not?
I'd love to show that to you. That is going to take some time. There's a whole decision-making process that is in place from GFOA, and I intend to share that with the administrative group.
Like a flow chart? A flow map?
Pardon me?
Like a flow map?
Hmm?
Like a flow map?
Yes, and it has a scoring that's associated with an analysis of a program.
I love that.
You can have it.
Great, thank you. And then the research academic return on investment.
Mm-hmm.
You said you do have more information on that?
There's a book on it. I'll refer you to the book if you'd be interested in that.
Yeah.
You help me remember these.
Or was it, the book is based on a study?
Research from GFOA, yes. Academic Return on Investment.
I'll look it up.
It's really good. You can go to GFOA, gfoa.org. A lot of this is free on their website. And I wish that every Michigan school district used this information. They don't. But I think you'll be better off after we start looking at it. Okay, I'm going to move along.
We have one more, Shane. Shane, you had something?
Okay. John, just to follow up on that,
sure.
On that top point there, do you think that that's something that starts on a building level, or do you think that's something that starts from administration taking a look at things and saying, here's the programs that we want to cut? I mean, like you said, we have a lot, and we continue to add since COVID has happened.
Yes.
Where do you think that starts? Does it start on the building level, or does it start from a cabinet level?
Like I said, I'm based on research. This is a lot of what drives this thinking. And this book, A Better Way to Budget, by Nate Levinson, says we've got to have the principals involved. The principals are at the root of understanding their needs and their buildings. So when we're asking about needs, we're going to hear from them first. So that goes right along with the sunset. So if in fact there's a program out there that needs to be considered, we need to hear from the principals. And if we don't have the data, we need to find data. So I mentioned IDEX or Munetrix. There's a good data source there as well.
Thank you.
You bet.
Any other board members?
You good?
Yes, thank you.
Personnel, biggest expenditure of the district includes salaries and benefits. Everything is usually 75, 80, 85% of what you do, so it's certainly worth spending good time on it. Looking at the positions that the district has right now, and as I mentioned, this process will building by building, you know, ask what are the FTEs this year and what is it that the principal is recommending next year. So it's that whole FTE look that helps drive this discussion on personnel. Looking at that class size, but still understanding special needs class size loads. What's the right size for support staff? Marketplace, are we competitive? Taking a look. Understanding that different communities have different needs. So when I say a community, and this came through the discussion, one elementary may be a community, but the other elementary over here may be a different community. So we need to hear about those needs from the principal. Look at the unfunded mandates. from the state, and we're, you know, we're so regulated that let's understand it and then have some possible communications through school associations. Onboarding training for new employees. We have mid-year turnover, and then the onboarding is always a challenge in every district. What about some sub-pools for various types of jobs? Create a budget to promote PD attendance, and this related to principals. If they're out of their building, you know, how do they handle that when they're expected to have some PD attendance? Review makeup. What I mean is the content of coaching employees versus contract. The point was made, we'd rather have employees do the coaching. We know we have a lot of contract people, but that's on the list. One person brought up, we need professional development for all, not just certain groups, but for all. And I believe that myself. If we're not refreshed and listening to this best research, if I'm not reading this research from GFOA, you know, it's easy for me to fall behind, but let's get that research. And here was another large one, I thought, cross-trained staff, because if people leave and nobody can do the job, you've lost all that knowledge when they leave. So we started to develop a list of those positions, and this probably isn't everything, but it was a start of the cross-training consideration. Take a look at the current initiatives before taking on a new initiative. We need to understand that. So let's have a list of what those are. Focus on training for new staff hired after the start of school, similar to the earlier one. But they said both professional and support. Understand the training necessary for Chromebook expectations. So that was professional development. The next section is supplies. Any feedback on professional development?
Sharon?
Yes.
This goes back to, it's just a comment actually, where someone had talked about unfunded mandates and having more state level discussions. Just know that those have been going on for a long time. I'm part of a couple committees at Macomb, the MISD, the Macomb County School Board Association, and that is one thing that's always been very high on our list of things to connect with our legislatures in Lansing. So I'm sure our staff are as frustrated as some of us are because we don't always get, you know, what we're looking for, but we're fighting.
Well,
and we have been for a while.
We need to be communicated because it takes such a chunk
it does.
Out of this budget.
Yep.
For both retirement.
Yep. It's huge.
Retirement and, you know, the mandates on what you can pay or can't pay for
yep.
health insurance.
Just on that same vein, too, we're also working very hard on going back to which a couple of governors ago had said, we're just going to borrow this money for a little while and then we're going to give it back to K-12 education, which
right.
never has happened. So every
yeah.
year we're still out there fighting for that stuff.
I think we're in a better place now.
We are.
You know, and I don't know what COVID did some of this, but we got some federal grants, and
yeah.
all of a sudden we have a reasonable budget.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
Yeah, I'm grateful for that.
Anyone else? Yeah. I have a couple. Can I go before you, Mary, if you don't mind?
Go ahead.
So, just because mine piggybacks on the unfunded mandate as well, as you read through it, though, it said, possible communications at state level, working through school associations. Was there any discussion on what school associations those would be?
There wasn't. That was just a general comment, but it's certainly MASA, which is the Superintendents Association. It's MASB. Those are the two big ones.
Okay.
And that's really where it needs to be. MSBO does not do those conversations.
We're not members of MASB.
You're not an MASB?
No.
Okay.
We were for a really long time, though.
You were for some time, okay.
No, actually, Macomb County individually, and this district in particular, have always been extremely well-received and very effective with their leaders in Lansing.
Okay.
So we at least got that going for us.
My other question, in regard to create a budget to promote PD attendance, do we pay for all personal development, don't we?
no.
We don't pay for all of our...
The answer is a big no.
And we, okay, but we also... Question? Do we pay for all of our staff's PD?
No.
Well, I was looking at Rochelle.
We provide required PD for all staff. We do not pay for all professional development for staff. So that's
say that one more time for me.
There is professional development to meet the requirements of the state and certificate renewal provided by the district for all staff, or for staff to meet that for certificate renewal.
So but anything above and beyond, we do not provide for.
In some cases, there are things that are not provided to all individuals that are in lieu of.
So not only do we do a financial, do take the financial burden of that, but we also give the opportunity, right? Because we run a lot of PD.
We must, correct.
Yes, okay.
You're required to offer very
allocated. Right. Okay. Thank you.
Okay,
Mary?
So we're going to go back to that. Understand unfunded mandates. Look at possible communications at the state level, working through school associations. That is lobbying. Correct? I mean, is there a different interpretation?
It's
for
not
that?
Actually lobbying.
What is it?
The organizations do some lobbying, they do. MASB and MASA do. And
so,
some of the ISDs do as well.
Well, I don't think that we're interested in paying people for lobbying.
We don't pay anybody to lobby right
no.
now. We don't pay anybody who lobbies for us.
What?
Not currently.
Not currently? When has this district ever paid anyone to lobby for them? Ever?
I think you can make a valid argument that MASB and...
They are lobbyists.
That they were, and the
NS. This is just a statement of a couple of principals today. And I don't think they had a specific organization in mind when they said that. I mean, this is just drawing out their opinion on this particular issue. They made that statement, so it's reflective here. That's all. It hasn't been vetted out beyond that.
Yeah.
Just that they're feeling. And whether or not they realize this is happening or not, it's clearly happening, and it's not something that they have to spend money doing, but like some of us spend a fair amount of time doing things like that. So I think that that's that's just something that they said was they felt like would be leading to this process, that's all. But I don't think they were
yeah.
any particular group or organization.
They were expressing their frustration,
right?
And that's how it ended up on a piece of paper.
Anything else,
Karen?
Yeah. Just a correction here. When we were members of MASB, I spent a great deal of time going up to Lansing just as an individual, as a board member, sometimes with our associations, all the districts in southeastern Michigan going up to Lansing, like in Lame Duck and that sort of thing. And we were all there just advocating for our schools. All we were doing was going there and saying, hey, this is what's going on, this is what we want to talk about, this is what you need to be aware of. These are not paid lobbyists. These are people who care about what's going on in education, who go up there and advocate for our schools. And so I think there is a very distinct line between lobbying and being a paid lobbyist and going up and advocating for your school as a parent or an association member or a board member. There's a huge difference. And
but there are paid lobbyists through the
yes,
association.
Yes, but MASB, I don't care how much certain members of this board don't like MASB, that doesn't mean everyone gets paid to do anything. And I really take exception with that comment, especially from people who were hardly involved with it. That's the end of my comment.
I'm going to move on to the supplies, purchase service. This is another category. So what we're doing, we're taking categories of the budget. And not the functions. You know what the functions are. Functions are elementary, middle school, high school. We're taking another slice of the budget. So this feedback was, let's look at the adequacy of the instructional budgets. Mainly talking about supplies. Understand district versus building expense, consumable expenditures related to programs. There seems to be some confusion that we can tighten up during this process. What about textbooks? When we have new students come in, or there's a change in an offering, do we have inventory in your building before we budget and spend. Understand those special ed contractor service needs. Sometimes we budget a new program, we're starting a new program, and all of a sudden we're scrambling for materials and furniture. So an intentional focus on that if there is something proposed. Understand the purchasing of formal bid items versus necessary immediate purchasing. There's some things that have to be purchased right now, usually smaller value. There's also some things that are formally bid. Let's understand that distinction and when that occurs through your purchasing process. Look at recurring building maintenance for both supplies and capital costs. This is in here because it's supplies. So what does that run? Now, what we're encouraging through this cost center is that we have that awareness building by building of what those maintenance supplies are, where in most districts that was lost in the shuffle. So we're going to be able to allocate that out once we have a recommendation from our facilities people. That recommendation is coming from facilities, but it will reside in that cost center by building. Understanding district copy costs. I spent half a career trying to understand district copy costs, and it's something that you just have to keep an eye on, analyze, and understand. Review the account structure. By account structure, I'm talking about your chart of accounts, where we have $4,000 accounts. Is that broken down so that it's giving us the best information? So we have a couple recommendations that right now, Rochelle has already, she brought it up. I'm going to format those differently so that you'll be able to get better information. Capital outlay. Okay, let's back up. Anything else on supplies versus services? Yes.
Are you in favor of, we have what we call P cards, or their credit cards that different teachers have,
right,
and they go out. I'm very much against it because we get the bill after all the money's been spent, and sometimes it gets quite costly with just ordering things that they could have ordered through the school and gotten if they'd have thought ahead. If they'd have thought a week ahead, they'd have had it at the school as opposed to running out and buying it.
You're asking if I'm in favor of those. I'm in favor of them when they are controlled properly and when they make sense. It doesn't make sense for bigger expenditures generally. It doesn't make sense for all expenditures. But to get away from these nickel and dime, $20, $10 expenditures, that's when it makes sense.
Yeah, but not when it's like $75 for a pack of colored paper that she could have ordered through the school. And
so we go back to the purchasing procedures then. So what do they say, and what does the district want to do? But they do have to be controlled. The cards have to be controlled, or they can be a challenge. Anything else on purchasing?
Shane?
I did. Amy had something similar I was gonna comment on was, I noticed too recently on our updates for the board, the business office has listed trying to get everyone, including new employees, to understand the procedures involved with that. And so I think as this process goes along, if we're going to keep the P-cards, and I agree within a certain reasonability of what those expenditures are, making sure that whoever has access to them knows the same guidelines for what they can and cannot use with it. Just uniform, so that way an expenditure here should match the same type here from different building to building. And I noticed that that's something that's appeared recently, so it appears that it's already on our radar, but just continuing moving forward with that.
If your auditor comes in, they don't see proper documentation, they'll probably bring it to somebody's attention. So that's something that is looked at after the fact as well.
So you say take inventory before budgeting.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean by inventory? Are you talking about books? Are you talking about chairs? Are you talking about computers?
Could be all those. So if we believe we have a purchase that needs to take place, let's see what we have before we ordered. So, you know, a classic example of this is in the elementary buildings, my elementary buildings when I was a business official, they had a room full of paper and art supplies, but yet they kept ordering and didn't take that inventory, subtract that off the order. That was my school district.
And so is the goal to have, say, I guess, Eric, you might know more about this, is the goal to, you know, ask our parapros to come in for overtime to do inventory, or?
I don't think we know the scope of this until the answer to that would be how much the scope would be. So if there was a purchase associated with something that we could already have, then we could figure out who would do the inventory. I think this is not something that someone says that they would like this, but it may already exist. So that would have to be developed, that process.
And remember, that's the one I said that I put on. That didn't come from your people. That came from me.
No, it does need to be done. There's no question. The only thing is I think inventory is an area of our facility that definitely has opportunity for improvement. Because, for instance, do we have inventory of our computers, even?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Every single one?
Yes.
Good deal.
Yeah, moving on to capital outlay. This is can be a costly one, but if you plan it, you plan ahead, it can be managed. So we're going to hear about that a little bit later. So we're going to hear update facility and equipment needs. Maybe not as much equipment, but you're going to see some equipment. And here are some examples. If you don't manage this, it starts to erode your general fund. So we're concerned about those things that should have been in another source of funding other than general fund, because don't manage it, it does take away from general fund. And somebody mentioned playground here. One of the principals said, well, what about playground equipment? How would we deal with that? So that, I think you're going to hear about later also. Prioritize. How would we prioritize these while understanding how that would take place? So I think you'll hear more. It's going to be helpful. Talked about developing some replacement cycles, technology, buses, support service vehicles, copiers, other depreciable equipment, so that they don't sneak up on you all in 1 year, and oh my gosh, we have to replace 7 buses in 1 year, we weren't planning on it. So we schedule these out. It's the scientific approach. Better understand the bid process. Grants. We have a lot of opportunities with grants. The COVID grants are in, and there's still decisions to be made on how that money is spent. How those are managed going forward strategically is going to impact your general fund. So the question is, what is legally possible to be expended through the COVID grants versus the general fund? Understand the rules. Got to understand the rules. The auditor is going to watch it, understand, and they're going to monitor these rules later. Develop input system for the remaining COVID funds. There's an MSBO seminar I brought up on grants that is going to look at this very issue. How can we be strategic on managing these millions of dollars of grant money so that it's to the district's best advantage in a legal fashion? Revenue. Market and promote school programming. What's acceptable out there in your area, the community in your region for marketing? Analyze the return on investment for marketing programs. That was for me. That was my statement. Encourage partnerships. And I looked at your list of top taxpayers. Well, it wasn't what I thought. You have DTE, and then you have, you know, some big box stores. I thought we'd see more manufacturing, but we didn't. But Selfridge came up is a possible place, and community organizations regarding community health. Maybe there's some partnership work that could continue there. Continue to review schools of choice impact on operations and learning. projection. We have one underway. This is part of my service, my work. I have contracted one in cooperation with your people at county office, and we will have that for you, the results, on November 15th. And it's going to be very user-friendly, very understandable, but it's a wealth of value. Minor cost. Study the need for revenue streams to facilitate broadband needs. Understand allocation of your enhancement millage. You are very fortunate. There are only 6 or 8 ISDs that have the enhancement millage. You are blessed to have that. Communicate with utility companies regarding rebate programs. Look at shared revenue cost reductions. There was something that happened years ago, parking lot permits, that helped reduce some costs. Re-examine that was the comment. What about concession vending? We have pop machines, Pepsi versus Coke, those wars. The other half of my career was dealing with those. So I spent half of my career dealing with coppers, the other half was concession vending. I'm just saying it can take a lot of time. Understand the carryover funds in building by building and propose some future need-based expenditures. Maximize student count. Communicate with utility companies. Some of these may be duplicated, so we're still cleaning up.
I have a question about revenue.
Let's go backwards.
Yeah. Revenue? Yeah.
Yes.
All right, so my first question, I couldn't agree more in regards to formalizing discussions with Selfridge. I think that that is a great partnership that we should encourage and be working on tremendously. I think that it is a hidden gem in our backyard, and any way that we can utilize that and develop a partnership with that, I think is outstanding. Can you talk a little bit about carryover? If we're zero-based budgeting, how are we having carryover?
It's a historical practice here in some buildings, and so we're proposing that be looked at. We haven't had any more detailed discussion than what I just said. So it ought to be looked at.
But even the thought process of carryover, doesn't that completely go against what zero-based budgeting is?
Well, that's why it's on the list.
Okay.
So you're going to address it, whether they're going to, it's going to be part of doing it is another thing. You're going to address why you have it and what are we doing with that money.
We're
justify it and what their plan is, building by building.
Yeah. I want to get rid of carryover.
Yeah, no, right. I thought we already got rid of carryover.
So the reason they use carryover right now is because they're basically saving their money for something bigger that they need. If you actually have capital outlay, which we have not been having in this district for a very long time, right, then you don't need carryover because you have capital outlay. It's just we're just trading off here.
Yes.
It's just a trade.
We asked them, based on the last conversation we had on this, we asked them to put in their budgets for the end year and the following year, what out of that balance was going into their budget. So it wasn't just a spend on money that didn't exist, it actually does go into the budget, so they do predict that fund. So it's not growing, it is actually part of the budget. The issue before was it wasn't in the budget, the money wasn't in the budget, it was just sitting there somewhere, but never was budgeted here. Now it is.
No. No, the problem with carryover was these buildings thought they had the money and the money wasn't in the budget. The money
Correct.
Was already spent
Correct.
Somewhere else.
Right.
So here we are holding the bag for like $1.3 million of carryover that didn't even exist.
But the,
That's
now,
true.
The issue yeah. is what we, the mitigating issue on this is that what we've done is that it is in the budget now. It's not, it's not tangible, it's in the budget. So it's not that it just comes off of money that wasn't in the budget. It's budget. But it would be, I think Don suggesting that
to me,
zero-based budgeting and carryover are not used together. His experience is that that's not
right. Carryover and zero-based budgeting to me is like jumbo shrimp.
I agree.
They don't go together.
Jumbo shrimp are delicious. Come on.
But they don't.
That was a comment from an administrator.
Okay.
So a lot of these are comments from administrators
right.
of people.
All of this.
So let's go backwards a bit. We're going to go back to capital outlay. Okay, you said prioritize capital outlay projects while understanding the process. What process are we talking about there?
It's 27.
Process of understanding your needs.
Understanding the capital outlay needs?
District needs for capital outlay.
And where does that conversation come from?
It came from your administrators understanding that you have capital outlay needs. I don't know that it came from anyone that you remember. And so you're going to have a presentation momentarily on capital outlay needs.
So capital outlay needs, we're suggesting, are only coming from maintenance or from buildings?
No. We certainly heard from principals as well as facilities.
Okay. All right. So next one. You said attend MSBO grant seminar. Who would be attending that? We're talking about grants.
I think it's probably going to be remote. So I'm recommending that Lisa and Nancy attend and the finance office to hear this insight on how we can best manage these grant funds strategically.
So I guess what I'm asking about this is that the only people that would benefit? Because our business office goes to these MSBO conferences every single year, and I can't believe that this would all be new information for them. Is there not more people in this district that would benefit dramatically from that information?
Not initially, because this grant work is so accountant-focused. It really needs to have the accountants listening to this, and this is going to be accountants talking to accountants.
But our math teachers teach accountants. I mean, that's how they get to be accountants,
they
right?
They don't deal with the grant funds. These grant funds are so difficult, and they need to be managed just right. So, MSBO is providing the leadership to the state on this. They've been excellent.
Eric, can I suggest that we have a lot of people that could maybe provide insight? Because if our business office has been attending these for this many years, and we really think there's all new information, that maybe we could, a fresh set of eyes would be helpful.
Yeah, it is a broader group, number one, and this is, I think specifically, this is a brand new one-time only grant. This is a totally different grant than it's existed before. So it's a one-time grant that has different requirements than any previous grants that we've received. It can be a broader group.
But fresh eyes are definitely helpful here. So on the next page, 30, we have analyzed the return on investments with marketing programs. What would a return on investment be for that?
If you paid someone for marketing services,
correct,
and you get 10 students back, it will likely have paid for itself more than once.
So if we get 10 students back, and we're educating 10 students at the cost of $10.5 per year on average, then our return on investment would be, so are we looking at what we're going to bring in, the revenue, or are we actually looking at a return on investment there? Because a return on investment would be profit from educating kids, which I guess.
Let me tell you, that was my comment. That didn't come from your group, but it's my experience of 40 years that marketing does pay off. And I'm an advocate of marketing.
Okay.
And once we see this enrollment projection, if it shows a trend going down, I may say, you might want to think about, doing some marketing to stop that decline, if in fact that's what happens.
Oh, you're definitely going to have to produce something we haven't seen before then. Okay, so.
Oh, you're going to see a really clear enrollment projection.
All right, we've seen it before. So we want to encourage partnerships. What goal is it that we would like to get from encouraging partnerships? What financial goal? Because this is a financial plan.
The more buy-in you get from a community and partners, the better off everyone is going to be. It takes many, many people to run a school district. And
correct,
if you have buy-in from out of the community through partners, it's always been better, in my view.
It's been better. There's no question that public relations is a tremendous part of our superintendent's job. But what financial goal are we looking for? Because this is a financial plan. This is under revenue. So apparently we're looking for revenue, but if by encouraging partnerships, which I agree with you, Hillary, it is wonderful for our district and our community, but I guess I'm wondering why that's on our financial plan. So what is the goal here? What's the financial goal of that?
To retain or attract students.
By discussions with Selfridge?
No.
Or community health?
No. The Selfridge would be to programmatically related. If there were partnerships, or if there was work on marketing, that would be to attract and retain.
How about if we flesh that out for the financial possibilities of that, given that it's under revenue? How about if we flesh that out and bring it back?
I have an answer. Under the appropriate review of the agenda for next week, I'm going to speak about a partnership that we're starting with an organization that is going to save money because they're providing a purchase service at without cost to the district. So if there was a need for a purchase service on X, whatever, and instead a community partnership is providing it for a reduced cost or for no cost, that could be, I'm just responding to a potential financial partnership.
I do understand that part. I guess we're saying specifically Selfridge or community health organizations. Those are both federal and state entities.
Right. Well, yeah.
And I have concerns because the feds or the state, they can't really give us money for our district. Revenue is kind of not really their thing.
Yeah, this came from principals today to start their thinking on this process. It's something that they are not used to stimulating their thinking on. So this is a reflection of what they said. My answer is something that I know that I'm working on.
Don't do that.
It's ideas they came up with.
I understand ideas. I guess I'm just wondering why this is listed under revenue, because I guess if you're thinking specifically revenue, this would definitely not be applicable.
It may or may not.
That very well could be in another category.
But wouldn't, like, if we got local businesses to have internships.
Correct.
That's not money coming in, but it's offering... It's cost benefit, so we might bring more students in because they're seeing these internships coming up.
And I totally understand that, and I agree with that. I guess because we listed specifically a federal entity and a state entity, it certainly is worth questioning. Okay. On page 31, we have study need for revenue streams to facilitate building needs. What does that mean? What are revenue streams?
It means if you have facility needs, how are you going to pay for them? Are you going to pay for them through general fund?
Is this a bond? Is this what this is?
I'm not saying what it was. It could be anything.
No, I'm asking.
We don't know. We need to.
What are possibilities?
We need to understand what your needs are, and that's what your district needs to pursue. What are those needs? Once you know those needs, then you figure out how to pay for them.
So what are examples of revenue streams that would
your
fit?
Your enhancement millage was a revenue stream.
Okay.
Right? There are others out there that you don't have available right at the moment.
So
there are grants that could be a revenue stream. You certainly had some capital outlay expended through the COVID money.
Certainly.
So there are a list of about a dozen revenue items that could fund things once you know and understand the need.
All right. Okay, so on page 32, we have review shared revenue from the prior year cost reductions. Something like, it says parking lot permits. Shared revenue from prior year cost reductions, what does that mean? I don't understand what you mean by parking lot permits.
It was difficult to articulate that.
Mm-hmm.
When you had some cuts years ago, there was something installed regarding parking lots that helped reduce that. This one's probably so minor that maybe even shouldn't be there, but I listed it because it was said today.
Okay, that was just a shift, actually, of the schools getting that revenue from coming to central office. So we also list under their maximize student accounts. What does that mean? Under decision-making parameters, revenue, page 32.
Oh, maximize
student accounts.
Don, that might be a typo. I think that principal said
It is a typo. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Like, this is hot off the press today, so that's at least the second or third correction I will make. And, you know, that was the purpose of the day, to expose it and get some feedback as well.
Excellent, student council.
So thank you. That is not correct.
So, I don't know. Okay.
Good?
Yep, that's close.
Financial integrity. This is something is over my career I've always interested in, want to see the districts work toward. And this process is transparent, user-friendly, collaborative. The long-term planning, a long-term financial plan. You're on your path to that. We want you to have long-term financial health and sustainability. We want people to understand school finance. So, your business office is going to be very helpful with that. They're helping me understand how your district operates in many ways right now. They're very articulate with that. But there's a lot more we can do. Long-range planning, how does that affect sustainability? Explain it. Every budget dollar has a job. If we can get the organization to, you know, operate in that way, we're better off. Communicate about your good financial management and maintain strong business services. When I see a school district that minimizes their financial management, I see a school district that then starts to head in the wrong direction. So you are blessed. This draft changed today, but I left it in here for you to get a sense on this process going forward. So on November 15th, we don't have the time yet, back in this room, we're going to bring you as much budget information as we possibly can, being put together right now. It's very likely we'll have that enrollment projection completed. And then we have other meetings. We have training meetings. We have the presentations by the various cost centers in March. Going through quite a series of meetings to balance this budget and get it down to something that can be recommended. Recommending that the Board of Education and administrators and supervisors meet again in a joint workshop right here, not confirmed yet, and then your final board action. So that's the timeline. Don't hold us to that timeline. It's evolving, and it'll be completed soon. With that, is there any more feedback, input, suggestions?
So in regards to the timeline, there's two dates that the board is held accountable for, that the board needs to be present, the November 15th date, and then when we choose to take action, correct?
And then a workshop in May.
A workshop in May, okay. Okay.
Some of this
is still
isn't
settled. Okay. How, let's go back to page 33.
What is page 33?
Help people understand school finance and how is that achieved? Who is that and how is that achieved?
Let me explain. I spent a career trying to get people to understand school finance. And I'm talking about community, I'm talking about the school district, I'm talking to everybody. So complex today, you have to have the ability to communicate that. So I think this process is going to help a lot because your people are going to know internally school finance, and they will actually be able to articulate this when completed. And the book I showed you, A Better Way to Budget, they talk over and over about the principles being your first line of communication out there. So
the goal, the plan there is to have the principals communicate the budget to help
we're
people, our public?
We're all going to be educators on school finance, get people to understand. And I'm going to lead that process and work with the finance office. You know, by the end of this process in June, we'll have much better financial literacy.
I'm still not understanding how our public transparency will improve.
They will see you operating very efficiently with good research and good communication on finance.
I think that's probably
the principals just won't know about, well, they're going to give me money, I got to spend it. They're going to know why they're spending it, when not to spend it.
That's awesome for us to know inside this school, but to our community, it should be a whole different animal. And I think there needs to be a solid plan for that. Certainly, it doesn't have to be done today, but I think just to start thinking about how we can communicate an improved budget process, or a zero-based budget to our community would be helpful. Because I don't think that's a principal part of their... We need principals to lead schools, not to convey budget information to the community.
I don't know. I think if we teach them how to do the money, then they're going to be better equipped.
Sure.
And
I'm talking about public dissemination.
No, the public, I don't know if they're going to understand what we're doing.
We can help.
But they don't understand the budget anyhow, so.
Okay. And then my next question, we see seek competitive bids for services. What does that mean? What services?
What's the full statement that you're reading?
November, on this draft of the timeline, seek competitive bids for services.
Anything that needs to be bid out for the following year budget, it could be any services that are logical to bid out at that time. So just an indicator, let's get started on it.
So what's that going to cost? My question is specifically related to, we've had an awful lot of issues with bids being, us paying people to do bids, which increases the cost, increases the everything. Is that being done in-house?
Likely.
Likely, or it's going to cost us a lot of money? We're going to, say, call in Plant Moran or somebody.
No, I think this is the way I was thinking about this is that anything over the bid threshold, a decision on whether or not to continue with the current purchase service or bid it out again to see if there's something more sometimes when we do bids, board approves a bid, they have like X amount of time and then a chance of renewal option.
Sure.
Or you don't exercise the renewal option and go out with it. So one of those types of things I'm just in my mind. So those would be bids that are routinely put out from the district to get competitive pricing over the bid gap.
I don't really want to pay Plant Moran or whoever to be writing our bids for us. I think that's a tremendous waste of money.
Any other questions for Don?
That concludes my presentation. Anything else you'd like to talk about?
Great. Do we have anything else for Don? No. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes. We, as a board, need to look at that November 15th date in regards to what time and what that looks like for everyone.
Yeah, how is it going to be a workshop if it's a communicable meeting date? We can't, necessarily do both because workshops generally take a bit longer.
Right.
Unless we just make the committee the whole little light for that day and just major focus on that.
It being earlier in the day because it is administrators having the fact that we have principals as a part
good
of that
point.
To have
good
it earlier
point.
In the day.
What day of the week are we talking about?
Monday, November 15th.
Regular committee of the whole day.
Nikki, what are our committee of the whole and full meetings for November? Do you know?
Yeah, 15th is being one week later. So
why 22nd? Did I think it was the 22nd and the 29th?
Wishful thinking.
Wishful thinking.
There's a lot of Mondays in November. Right?
One's probably Thanksgiving.
Okay.
Halloween's
Monday. Oh, right. We're the second. We're the third and fourth Monday. That's why. Okay.
Could we do something like we do for the org meeting, like have something ahead of the regular meeting schedule? I mean, I'm not sure how long. Don, how long do you think a workshop? 2 hours? Okay. So could we do something like that? Like do that part before we would have a regular scheduled meeting of the whole?
Do we want to do something along those lines? Maybe we do the, I'm going to call it the zero-based budgeting at 1 o'clock,
And then he said it's going to be roughly 2 hours, so then we could roll, we could all leave and go eat dinner and come back for Committee of the Whole at 6:30. Does that sound like something
or
we want to do?
Or could we move it closer to when the Committee of the Whole works? Is that an issue for you at all, or no?
I have a feeling 2 hours is not going to be enough.
I have a feeling too, but I think if we do it at 1,
we get it done at 3. We go eat, go someplace.
3 or 4.
Eat. Yeah.
Right.
We have time to come back.
Come on, we need more input here.
Just we no said, eating at the board table.
We said we need the principals for this. Is that what it
yes.
is?
Yes. Correct.
So they need to be out of school at that time, yeah, correct?
With us. We're
yes. Right.
Here or in a larger room, you need to be here, correct?
Yeah, they're not. You know, it's
we can
like
meet in the gym.
Where's
the
larger room?
Maybe a rehearsal room, something like that. Or here we find.
Okay, but they're not going to be out at 1 o'clock. Is that a half
well,
day
they're
for
gonna,
anybody?
No, but
how
they
about
might
two,
have
how about 2
o'clock? They might have had to figure out.
I think 2 o'clock would work. Do you want to do 2 o'clock?
Is there a problem with 1? Even I will make it.
I don't have a problem with 1.
I don't have a problem with one.
But it just feels like we could refine it a little bit more.
Well, we're going to have the teacher. They have their lunch. They come into this meeting. And then, because their day ends usually around 3:30.
Let's not keep them longer. Let's do it at 1.
Well, yeah,
that
all
way they're only
gone
for a half day.
I know,
so
but if they started
like,
at 1, if they came in for the meeting at 1, and we should be done somewhere around 3 o'clock.
No, second year principals are out.
Yeah, they won't be done. High school will be done.
And then they can go back to school if they need to do something.
Are we talking?
Just roll right into it? What does that do for notification, though?
That's okay. We don't have enough time to do it. I have to post it as a workshop.
No. If we roll right into, if we say we're going to do 1 at 1 o'clock and we end at 3 o'clock and we roll right into it.
Okay, yeah.
Right. It's because of the way we notify the public.
Not enough time.
5 o'clock, 4 meetings.
A 3 o'clock and a 6 o'clock meeting? Or post? You're thinking posting at 1 o'clock and a 3 o'clock and just go from one to the other.
You know, your point of having a break is something we should really seriously consider. We might need to have that little break time in there.
I couldn't agree more, but if I'm in the minority, I'm trying to
find
one to
No, I think 1 o'clock and 6:30 are fine.
Does a 1 o'clock one work best for the teaching staff?
Yeah. We're going to have the principals here.
Let's just make a decision.
Like 1 and 6:30? Because it seems like that's the consensus.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Or is this how it's going to work?
I know. I'm sorry. You're in the minority.
Does that work?
Yeah, that's yay.
As far as I'm concerned, it works.
You get us all day. You should all be so excited. You get us all day long.
Just one day.
Let me know.
Yes.
So 1 p.m. workshop.
Okay. That's the 15th.
Yep. And 6:30 committee hall.
All right. Anything else? All right. Next presentation.
We would need a break in between.
Let's see if we can get through the audit before we break then.
I was just asking the question. I mean, you know, it's 8:20, right?
Jennifer's been so patient with us.
She's good, too, so it's all right.
Before she starts, does anybody need a hard copy of the draft documents that you received in your mailboxes?
Got them.
They're in the mailboxes.
Let me go grab my
I gotta go grab them out of my mailbox. They're in our mailbox?
Well,
you got another one? Yeah, that'd be great.
You know what?
Look, you got it right there.
Thank you.
Oh, Lord. Don't do anything small. Don't do
That's
anything
our copying
small.
Budget.
Just for this.
Give us the highlights.
Because the kids are all doing everything in Google Docs.
Right.
All right, thank you guys for having me. I have been here for the presentation last year. We did the Committee of the Whole last year as well. I communicated to you through email as well. So if you didn't see it, my name is Jennifer Watkins, or if you have
trainings. I do a lot of them, and I'm there. And it is a huge, complex issue. We're going to get into a little bit of the federal funding. I will try to hit the high points that I think is important for the board to be aware of during this process. Of course, if you have questions, I can take them here. If you have more detailed questions, I can also meet with you before next week's meeting to go over any of those or answer anything that I either don't have the answer for or you want to spend some more time on. So in general, you get three documents. Next week at the meeting, we're going to go over a PowerPoint presentation that will be much more condensed, which is good. It's good to have this process either as a committee of the whole or at a finance meeting to go over details and then go over more high level, a quicker, higher level version for the next board meeting. So three documents. You have a governance letter. It is a few pages. Then you have it's either if you're looking at it online or up here, it's usually denoted with the GL in the name. And then you have a single audit, that's over your federal dollars, that's noted as a SA normally in the name, and then the financial audit, which is the big document. That's your regular financial audit. It also includes your comprehensive annual financial report. So this letter is to board and management. I'm just going to highlight a couple of things. A lot of it is kind of boilerplate, new standards that came out, new standards that are coming out later. GASB is keeping us very busy. They have in your financial statements, there's up and coming about 10 new standards. None of them that are coming out this year or next year are going to significantly affect your financial statements. The last few that we had that significantly affected was GASB 68, 75, obviously, and then 84 that we had with student activity funds last year. In this letter as well, we have items on your estimates. So as auditors, we need to make you aware of anything at the board level that is an estimated number in your financial statements, which are right here. I will read them to you. All of these estimates, just so you know, have to deal with your district-wide statements. When we go into your numbers, I will kind of delineate which ones they are, but none of them have to do with budgets, things that you're budgeting, or your governmental funds, like your general fund, your food service fund, or all those district-wide numbers, those full accrual numbers that will go over kind of the difference between the two. The other thing I wanted to mention in this letter is, it's kind of hard to go from the PDF to the hard copy, but on page 2, it talks about a few different things. Difficulties encountered during the audit, corrected and uncorrected misstatements, disagreements with management, all of those types of things. That would be noted in this letter if anything happened. So if you had a disagreement over how something maybe should be reported, if we found material audit entries, or if it was taking a long time to get information, so if we asked for something and it was taking weeks or they couldn't find something and there wasn't supporting documentation for things and it was a material issue, we would note that and we would report that to you. There was none, but I'd like to point it out just so you know where to look for that and just that we would be reporting it to you if we had any. Those are the biggest highlights in this portion of the letter. The next one I'm going to go over, I guess I'll start smallest to largest. Not that any of them are more important than the others. Next I'll go over the single audit. So that's in the name of it, if you have it in PDF form, has an SA in it. And if you're looking at it on paper, it's the second largest document. So the single audit is a report that's required if you receive over $750,000 of federal dollars, if you spend actually over $750,000. The first few pages are, again, more boilerplate language. With single audits, there's a lot more reports that we have to issue because we're deeper dive at compliance, a deeper dive of internal controls. So anything that touches your federal dollars, you have a whole other compliance supplement, like 100-page document, that you have to comply with, different reports, different things that you have to look at, a lot of different special tests that you have to do for each of those documents. We're looking at all of that for each expenditure in those categories. And as well, for single audit specifically, we're looking at internal controls over all those areas as well. So you can get reports on them from the auditor. If we found material weaknesses or significant deficiencies, they would be noted in these reports, or they're called what we say unmodified, and that is what you received over your financial findings in federal programs. So then you have quite a bit of federal dollars, and they're all listed out here in your single audit. And I definitely, normally I don't go over these pages, but this year I just wanted to show a little bit of what they were, because there was so many changes in last year related to the COVID-19 funding. So anything that you received that is kind of what they would say is a one-time grant related to the CARES Act or related to COVID-19 is noted. The state wanted to make it very clear of what those funding types were. So if you, I'll go back to the beginning, but if you look in food service, there's COVID-19 programs in food service. The first section is related to all to food service. So you can see there's the department total for agriculture. So all that funding shifted. It normally was under National School Lunch Program, and it all shifted to summer food service, COVID-19, which increased the rates that you were receiving for those items as well. And it also had new requirements, new things. Last year we talked a lot about, or you heard a lot, especially at year end, June 30th, 2020, the CRF funds, they were called, or coronavirus relief funds. That was the COVID funding that came through on the state aid. That was new one-time funding that was received last year. So that's right here. And that was actually audited as well. We audited three programs, so I'll go over those. But all of these items are all related to COVID and all under the CRF program. And then also ESSER, which has been called ESSER, it's GEAR, but it's Elementary and Secondary School Emergency Relief Funds. There's ESSER 1, ESSER 2, ESSER 3. I'm waiting for probably ESSER 4 to come out. And they all are related to COVID as well. So all one-time funding. They all had different requirements, and then they changed it to all have the same requirements. They said it was, you know, could be spent last year, and then they said, oh wait, no, not a portion of it had to be spent the next year. So all of those changes were happening, and a lot of them were happening as of June 30th of 2021, and then some of them came even after year end. So we got some word of things that had to be deferred and changed as of July, I think, 14th. And it's evolving, so they're coming out now and giving more details probably of what the MSBO conference will have to do with is probably ESSER 3, I'm guessing, and the APR program for those. So overall, as a district, you guys had for current year expenditure, that's been the number that we're looking at for what was spent for federal funds, and that was $13 million. And I'm going to flip back and forth. But we audited, so as we have a process we go through to pick what is your major programs. We specifically targeted coronavirus relief funds, Title I, and education stabilization funds. Some of the funds you normally get, we go through a process where you have to audit them every 3 years. So there's a process of finding out, is it type A, type B, all of these things, and we have to audit them. So like Title I, IDEA flow through, or sometimes called special ed, and nutrition cluster or food service, all normally hit that bucket. And they all have to be done every third year, if not more. And because the education stabilization funds, or ESSER, 20% of your federal dollars audited, but we did over 40%. So just so you kind of have an idea of what this federal funding is doing and that how much we were looking at it from an audit perspective. The other item I wanted to show on this report is page 11. I think this is a good tool for the board to kind of see. It's kind of, I say it's like a report card for the audit. I would say it's kind of weird that it's in the single audit document because it does really go for both. It goes for your financial audit and for your single audit. But it kind of gives you an overall quick look to say, okay, you know, how did we do? And it's very specific. The format is very specific. The state requires you, and the uniform grant guidance, this is how it has to be set up. So if you had any material weaknesses, significant deficiencies, material noncompliance, it would be marked yes. The top section is for your financial statement audit. The bottom section is specifically over your federal awards and those major programs we tested. So you can see you want to have everything under the no category, and you can also see you had unmodified opinions. Also, when this gets submitted to MDE and Treasury, they're flipping to this page almost immediately. That's what they want to see. They want to see if you had findings, what they were over, what's the plan to address them.
Question. I circled it somewhere. There was a pass through the MISD, and there was a pass through through Copper County ISD. What exactly was that? Like, not what was it, but like, why did we get something through a different county's ISD?
I'm not sure. That might be a resolved question of why it came through that for the CFA, the Schedule of Federal Awards. Any pass through, if it's direct, most of the time it's from Michigan Department of Education. Some of it's from Oklahoma County. But I think it's the MASA device.
It is. I'm sorry. It's on page 6. Yes, it's there. Sorry.
Every district that I have in Oklahoma County, we do like 9 or 10, they all received it. And it was all from Copper County. But I know I've caught it on a lot of other CFAs that it was labeled wrong. But I'm not sure. Usually, I think they got it, and either they weren't able to spend it is a typical reason. I don't know exactly for that one specifically. And then they see what other districts could use it to make sure that they are doing it properly. So kind of just like it flows through Macomb County, they get the backup, they make sure they can spend it, but the actual direct dollars went to them first, and then you're like a sub-recipient to them.
It just seemed like a very benevolent thing for us.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
That was definitely a new one for me this year.
I was like, did I miss this last time? All right, thank you.
Okay, now we'll go into the financial report, the large report. If you're pulling it up on your computer, FS is labeled in the name. So, again, obviously, we're not going to go through this entire report because we would be here until tomorrow morning, probably. But it is a comprehensive annual financial report. It's new that you're not supposed to use, you have to use the whole terminology now. We don't label it CAFR anymore, so if I say that, you can correct me. As I said, they're always coming out with new things that we definitely need to be changing and be aware of. But this has a few different sections in it, so I'm going to focus on, I guess, the auditor more section. All of it is reviewed by the auditor. Some of it is audited, some of it is unaudited. It's labeled for you specifically. It's in the report. And I'll go over kind of what each section is just so you're aware, and then if you want to take, you know, a better look at it or read that section specifically at a different time. It's all kind of related. The information, obviously, is all the same year, and it's all interrelated in some way as well, but it's kind of placed differently. Table of contents is unaudited or audited. So with a comprehensive annual financial report as well, you have specific requirements. It's kind of like another level. So you have your audit, then you have government auditing standards, another level of audit to make it even more complex, I guess. Then you have your federal awards are over that limit, so you have informed grant guidance that you have to follow, and then you have a comprehensive annual report, so you have some more ASCPA guidance and guidance that you're giving for how that has to be laid out very specific. So this table of contents really is helpful when you get your hard copy of this report. We'll give you kind of tabs with it, so it's nice for you to be able to have it handy if you want to look at something specific. But it tells you right here if it's unaudited, it will label it directly. So, like the transmittal letter, we can't audit that. And then everything in the financial section, because we say unaudited, it's audited. I just like to point that out. So the whole. Section 3 is the MD&A, and I'm not going to go over that. I'm going to go over first the independent auditor's report and then go to the right to the basic financial statements. Rochelle and her team write management's discussion analysis that is required by GASB 34 that is included in your financial statements. I always say, if you're in the school district I live in, I like to read that section. If you're not big on financial statements or into accounting, and this is a very large report, that gives you a good picture of kind of budget to actual items that happened, maybe plans for next year, what's going to happen, just more of a narrative format instead of just numbers and statements. So I like that section personally. It gives just more of an overall viewpoint of exactly what happened in the district, but it does include the figures that are in the audit. And section 2.1. Independent auditor's report, I like to point out a couple of things on this report. This is an unmodified report. That is what you want to see. MDE actually will not accept anything besides the unmodified report for a school district. So they require all school districts are audited. They all have to be submitted by November 1st, and they all have to have unmodified opinions. I don't know. I think you just can't buy that if it doesn't have one and it withhold state aid. I've heard Gloria make that comment before. But you did receive unmodified, and it's kind of a whole basis. This letter is why you receive an audit. It states management's responsibility, that their responsibility is those financial statements. So the numbers in your financial report, those are what the business office or finance is putting in there. They're doing the reconciliations, they're in charge of internal controls, they're in charge of making sure that the items in that business office, those transactions that we're looking at, those accounts, those numbers are reconciled, and that the process to get them there was done correctly. So the auditor is not coming in and changing the amounts or reconciling figures. That would not leave us to be independent. And so we're coming in under the auditor's responsibility and giving you that independent look. So we're the third party looking to say, okay, is that number accurate? Is the internal controls that got it to that place where it was that number, were those all in place? Do we see anything that we need to change? Is there a adjustment that needs to be made with that number? And as I mentioned in the letter, if we found any adjustments that were in a material nature, and we have a calculation for that, we would have to notify you. And if we ever found one that was material, it would lead to a material weakness. So having no material adjustments is very good for you to know as a board, because that means we're not finding large entries that need to be adjusted. It means everything was ready and reconciled when we came out for audit, and it's not causing material weaknesses. But it also means the numbers I would say they can't do a whole year in a week. We're looking at dates and things when we're out here pulling transactions. But there's also a lot of things that gets prepared for the audit when we come out. That is, some of it is one time, especially when you're dealing with district-wide information, different accruals, things that you're only doing one time a year, like bond schedules, things with the footnotes. And that's a lot to prepare, so you have to keep up on it all the time during the year, such as like the bank drives and the processes for other things, so that you're not having to do everything for the audit. So it always tells me that we're not having large adjustments out here for audit, that things are running smoothly, and the numbers that you guys are receiving on a monthly basis or when you're getting your financial reports are good numbers as well. At the top of page 2-2, I definitely won't read it to you, but that's our opinion, and that is also kind of gets the whole point of this report is that opinion. So the opinion is where we actually state that it's unmodified, and that we say that these financial statements are beyond a doubt fairly presented in all material respects. And then section 3, this is the management's discussion and analysis. And some numbers, because it is for GASB 34, are dealing on that full accrual basis. So if you do look at it or get it at home, there is some information on full accrual. But I like the section specifically, starting on just checking, on 311 over to 312. It kind of gives you like an outlook for what's going on now and next year's budget, which sounds like you guys are going to be talking a lot about budgets, but it gives you a very good synopsis of it. So then we will go to 4-1, which is starting this with the first page of the basic financial. And these are based, the 401 and 402 are what they call full accrual statements. So they are, I always kind of put it, like if you had a for-profit entity, this is what you would see. They GASB made changes to try to get a fuller picture of a school district, or all governments really, it was all governments. On a full accrual basis. Normally, what you are used to seeing on a monthly basis in school districts for years and years and years were on what they call a modified accrual basis. So 4-1 and 4-2 include a few things that are in the normal everyday funds that you're used to seeing, and we'll show those as well. But it starts out here. So you have capital assets, which is about halfway down, I'll use my mouse. Capital assets not being depreciated, capital assets net of accumulated depreciation. So once a year, these financial statements are done for audit, and the fixed base goods, fixed assets, property, plant, and equipment are put on these statements. And then they are tracked, and all that capital outlay and things that are included in your regular fund financial statements during the year. If it's a capital outlay purchase, gets put on for fixed assets. So it's a difference kind of between your cash accounting, if you spend the cash, or if